Worship you in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So this song that we're about to do is a Kinyarwanda song. I don't know how many of you have ever used the green book. If you know the green book, you know the green book. okay, just a few of you. So this song is pretty old, but it's about praising God and saying about, it starts with, those who belong to Christ, they are joyous about his name. So today, it seems like it's about worship and praising God. So no matter what you're going through today, I just hope that you praise God like never before. Yeah?
Shimira, Oh, thank you for the sacrifice you have paid for us, Lord. We give you more than the songs, Lord. We give you our hearts this afternoon for your glory, God.
Sing, I love your voice. I love
Faithful in your love, oh God, even when we fail you, even when we fall and we don't feel worthy of your love, you still love us and you're still faithful. And this afternoon we come to give you praise. We come to praise you, oh God. We've come to say, so will I. If the nature obeys you, if the nature praises you, so will we. And I pray that, Lord, it will ring out in our lives, oh God. It will ring out in our lives that we will praise you no matter what. We thank you, Jesus.
So black.
Hallelujah. 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 He's the one that never leaves the one behind. My goodness, it just dawned on me that even God's own chosen Israel nation, the Israelites, at one point didn't get an opportunity to get to go to before the Father, just like today we have. That they had to send a representative who would go and they would hope he would survive. But today we have assurance that we have life before the King. My Lord, my goodness, do we understand the privilege we have in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ? Do we understand the magnitude of his love for us? I just want to read in Romans chapter 5, verse 8, and this is what it says. But God demonstrated his own love towards us in that while we were still sinners, oh my God, Christ died for us. Amen. God thought of you and me and felt it was he just gave a sacrifice. He could have sent a lamb. He could have chosen some other way. But he said, these people, my people, are precious, that I'm going to die for them. And my friend, the good news is that even you, God thought of you in the most discreet of ways, in the most clear of ways. And to him, he knows you by name. And for me, that excites me. I don't know about you. I don't know about you. That I am in good books with my Lord. My Lord and Savior. That he spared not his life. My God, if he died for me and gave his own life, what more cannot he do for me? Is it heal me? Is it give me what? Is it give me health? Is what? I don't think there is. I'm afraid there isn't anything that the Lord will not do for you or you do for me. And we have to believe and we have to get to hold on to our King. Because he is Lord. I don't know what you're going through, but I just want to tell you that the Lord knows you. He knows your situation. And he's interested. You know what? We have friends, we can get to know the problem and hope and say, I will pray for you. But God will not say that. He will say, I care about you and I'm going to get involved into your matter. We have a good God. And this afternoon, I want you to join me in giving a thunderous shout for the Lord, because he's our King. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Amen. Thank you. Thank you, CLA. Yes, this is like it, my friends. I think we have an idea of how it will be in heaven, right? Thank you so much. Oh my God, a wonderful choir. Jessica, where are you? Well done, guys. Thank you, guys. Man, I don't know about you, but the worship takes me to a certain place. And this afternoon, I was just there. And I thank God so much that I'm sharing this with you. So good afternoon once again, CLA. Yes, thank you so much for coming to worship with us this afternoon, because there is the presence of the Lord in this place. I am so glad. Yes, I'm so glad that you're here with us this afternoon. And you know what? My name is Joshua. Oh, if I forget. My name is Joshua Tahinduka, and I serve in the vineyard of the Lord, in the shamba, specific shamba called the men's ministry. Yeah, there's a specific small field or big field, depending on how you like to call it, in the men's ministry. And I serve with the man of the Lord, Pastor Hassan, here. And it's such a joy for me to do that. But also specifically this afternoon, I'm so privileged to host a service this afternoon. And the wonderful people, our wonderful members of church that are following online, thank you so much. We rejoice with you that you decide to come and partake of the Lord this afternoon with us. Thank you for signing up and being with us on YouTube and many other platforms. So, again, before I get carried away, clearly you can see. Let me just welcome the most important people of this moment, the guests that have come to visit us for the very first time, and you're here. Please raise your hand up, shoot your hand up, because you're before the Lord. You're in your Father's home. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for worshiping with us.
ushers are coming to see you. They have two cards. One is an information tag, and I was telling people in the services prior that I like the card because I can use it in my Bible to put where I stopped reading. Please keep it with you. Don't throw it away. Keep it with you. Put it in the Bible, actually, and always read with this. And then there's an information card for us to get to know you, to call you by name. And right after fellowship, right after the third service, please go join the hospitality room. It's over there on my extreme right. You find a room. You find wonderful people that will speak to you. They will answer some of the questions you might have about CLA. And if you are here for a very long time, please make this your church. But if you're also transitioning and decided to visit us this afternoon, please send our love. Send our love and greetings to them. And tell them we still worship a living God. And we are not about to change that. So thank you so much. And you know, why don't we receive the church news from our wonderful tech team?
Hello, CLA family. Hope you're all doing well. My name is Jared. I'll be your host for today. And this is Church News. Let's get into it. Every Monday, we have women's prayer altar at 5 a.m., 1 p.m., and 10 p.m. On Tuesdays, we have our regular prayer service from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. Make sure not to miss out. Every Wednesday, we have cells in our home neighborhoods, an amazing opportunity to grow in community, in faith, and in family. Be there. Every Thursday, we have men's prayer altar from 5 a.m. to 6 a.m. Make sure not to miss. Every Friday, we have intercessory prayers that happen from 6 to 8 p.m. here at CLA. Every Saturday, we have campus fusion happening here at CLA from 5:30 p.m. to 8 p.m. All the campus students, don't miss out. It's an awesome time. To all the young adults, 119 is back for a reproduction. Confused? Check this out.
Join us at the 119 Retreat, aka RRR, a life-changing event for young adults taking place in the picturesque surroundings of Lake Kivu. This edition's theme is Reproduce, and it's all about empowering a generation to extend Christ's influence in the spheres of life, drawing inspiration from 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 4 to 7. Don't miss this incredible opportunity to engage in extended times of prayer and time alone with God and gain valuable insights from our very own Pastor Hassan and John Chibirango. Secure your spot now for only 70K with the option of payment in installments available. Mark your calendars for November 10th to 12th and be part of a life-changing event at Saint-Benoît Tigoufi Rubavu. We can't wait to see you there.
So, if you're excited, just as I am, make sure to register at the back after the service to get more information and learn about what's going to happen there. To all the university students, my campus Fusion family, Fusion Vibe is coming up. If you know, you know. If you don't, make sure you're there on the 28th of October from 5 p.m. Don't miss. And to all our CLA family, we'll be having a week of prayer and fasting from the 16th of October to the 20th. Also, we'll be having evening rallies every night from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. Make sure you're there.
fill me up. My heart is satisfied.
Oh, well, that's all we have for today. I've been your host, Jared. We hope you have an amazing service and an amazing Sunday. See you next time.
Jared, for being a wonderful host, but also to the tech team. These guys do a lot of hard work. Let's give them one more round of applause for the wonderful work you guys do. So just a few verbos. One is that parents with children aged below three years, please know that we have two nursing rooms right at the back, just for you, so that you can nurse and help the baby in there, but as you continue to listen to the word, so that you don't miss out, because that's why we come before the Lord, to listen to the word and also be part of the worship. And then also for those that have children 3 years and above, please take advantage of the kids' connection. The kids' connection happens during the first service and the third service. Let's take our children there to start learning. There's a wonderful and dedicated team that is supporting them, that is helping them to, in their own way, to understand the gospel. So please do that. And also, it will create room for more people to use the nursing room. So kindly, if you have a child that is just above 3 years or 3 years and above, please take them to Kids Connection so they can also find their friends and enjoy, but also create space for those that need to use them. The second announcement that I have is that we have a lost and found table right at the back, close to the hand washing station. If you have anything, maybe you might have lost something in one of the services, or you're here and lost something, please pass by. You never know, that thing could be there. And then finally, this is an announcement from the parking team, the people that help us to make sure that we park very well, but also have a bit of order. They've requested me to request you that please, as you come to church, get fast parked before people can get out of the car. Because what happens is that we create embouteillage, and no one wants embouteillage at church. We all want to, especially when we are late, we just want to quickly get into the church, and I guess that's why. So please, let's avoid the temptation of creating jam. Let's clear the way so that other people, at least if you want, you can extend just below where there's not many cars going, so that the people can get out, and then the other cars coming from up. It's also dangerous for kids, because sometimes they could open the door or any other person, and they get knocked. So let's try to minimize the fatalities that could happen. But again, let's also honor them, because they help us. You know, they come to church to help us attend church effectively. Can't you put our hands together for them? Yes, they volunteer and sacrifice for us. So when they ask you, please, when they ask you to do something, do it. Because they are doing it out of service and love. All right? So thank you so much. Now, we are getting into a wonderful section of serving with our substance and giving our tithe and on offering. The details already projected up, but then also at the end you'll have a chance to do use a POS if you like. So let's pray for offering, but also dedicate a pastor Pastor Peter, who's going to share with us the good news that the Lord has put on his heart. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you because you're a good God. We've been singing of your grace, and your grace has no boundaries. We've seen your provision in all ways. Everything we have and everything we are, everything is yours, Lord. And therefore, in this moment, we've come before you with a posture of gratitude, to worship you with our substance. May you might apply it to do your work here at church and in the boundaries. And Lord, may you continue to be glorified even more. At this very moment, I want to bring to you your servant, Pastor Peter, whom you've pressed a word on his heart to share with us. I pray that, Lord, you give him clarity, you give him utterance and all ways that you've planned for us to be able to understand. But us seated in the pews, may you clear our understanding. May you create an inner hunger. And also, Lord, may you make us fertile soils to receive your word that will end up into bountiful multiplication. We thank you, Lord. We honor you and worship you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good afternoon, everyone. So this song we're going to do is pretty old. not sure how old it is. I might be a little younger than it, but it's a really great song. It's about consecration. It's more of a prayer song as a clay, telling God to use you, to mold you the way He wants. So if you know this song, it's called Potter's Hand, please don't hesitate to join us. It would be great. Thank you.
Thank you.
your word says that we'll become living sacrifices and we'll be only drawn to you, God. That everything that we are will be for you, and wherever you tell us to go, that we'll go. Whatever you say that you tell us to say, that we'll say and do what you do, God, and nothing else. I thank you for what you do, God, in us. As your vessels, as your clay, may we not complain as clays when you want to shape us in a certain way.
I appreciate the worship team once again. Thank you, Jessica and the band. It's also appreciate everyone that is serving, the camera guys, tech team, ushers, hospitality ministry, everybody. Hello, church. How are you doing? Yes, for those who are visiting CLA for the first time, my name is Peter. And I'm delighted to be sharing with us the Word of God this afternoon. I'm just going to request us to rise on our feet as we allow these words or these lyrics to sink in our hearts. Make it a personal prayer. Allow Jesus to mold you. Allow Him to use you and to fill you. I want you to close your eyes as we pray and say, in your hands, crafted into your perfect plan, you gently call me into your presence, guiding me by your Holy Spirit. And it says, teach me, dear Lord, to live all my life through your eyes. And she goes on to say, this is, I think, Darlene Check, I am captured by your holy calling. Set me apart. I know you're drawing me to yourself. Therefore, lead me, I pray. Pray for yourself and tell God to set you apart this day. Could be watching us online from wherever. May God speak to you. May God touch you. May God mold you. May God make you, shape you, and form you into what He wants you to be. Holy Spirit, I invite your presence in this auditorium. I pray that God will go beyond what words can do in the hearts of your children that are under this roof and those that are watching us. And I pray that Holy Spirit, you alone will bring the truth to our understanding, that we will know that Jesus, we are not ours. We belong to you, and you want us to do more than probably we are doing. You want us to see what you are seeing. You want our hearts to be burdened by what burdens you. You want us to be captivated by your Holy Spirit. Guide us, lead us. Set us apart, mold us, make us what you want us to be. And Lord, as I share your word with your children, I want to pray that whoever came in through these doors with a heavy heart will be released by the power of your Holy Spirit. And whoever entered here with a challenge, may the Holy Spirit lighten that burden. We are in your presence, and we cannot afford to walk out the same as we got in. Come and deal with every matter. Deal with every issue that has troubled our souls, that we may be able to worship you in truth and in spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Give a mighty hand clap to Jesus. Praise the Lord. Welcome once again. Like I said to those that are new, my names are Pr. Nkunzingoma. I serve here at Christian Life Assembly as the lead pastor. And I'm very honored. I will be sharing with us. I am going to be introducing us to our new series about missions. And I hope you are excited. But before I get into that message, I don't know whether I have those photos on the screen. I want to make this announcement to us. Yesterday, we had a leadership handover from our dear Pastor Richard and Pera, handing over to the new leadership of Christian Life Assembly Rwimiyaga in the Eastern Province. And so we were there to celebrate them and to celebrate the incoming pastors. Here they go. So this is Pastor Raisa, Jean-Paul and Raisa. I think that is the way to go. This is Pastor Richard and Pera handing over to this young couple. And we want to thank God for them. Praise the Lord. So from yesterday, Jean-Paul and Raisa are our new pastors for that branch church. Very wonderful couple, and we believe they are going to do great thing. Pastor Richard and Pera have done a very great work, a tremendous job. They have transformed the communities through the love of Christ. They had an initiative with the support of this church to put up a primary school. Right now, it's at grade five or primary five. And you seem not to. Let's celebrate them. And the church apparently has about 400 that gather every Sunday in that auditorium. And that school has about over 250 pupils that come to that school. And we really want to thank God for him. Not only that, there are many lives that have been touched. We've had different testimonies of what God has done through them. And so we thank God for them. And Pastor Prince, our worship pastor, couldn't make it today. He told me yesterday that I will not be in church because I want to make sure I bring Daddy and Mommy back to Chigadi. So I'm like, yes, he wants to drive them back here. Yeah. Okay. So I'll be talking about missions. And I will start by the definition of the word mission itself. Mission comes from the Latin verb missio. Now, that sounds like a bit of French, which means to send. So literally, missions has to do with sending. And when we talk about sending, we are also talking about going, okay? You send, but you can also go. We'll get to that in a little while. And Merriam-Webster Dictionary says it is the act of sending or the state of being sent or delegated by authority with certain powers of transacting business. And that is what I would want to emphasize as the purpose, the reason why the church exists, to transact God's mission in the world. And we are delegated. We have the authority and the power to transact kingdom business wherever we are. And so I am just going to set this up, kind of whet your appetite. And in the next few Sundays, we are going to be focusing on the priority of missions by different preachers. And we'll be talking about the purpose of missions and the price of missions. But before I get deep into my message, I felt I needed to share with you some of the highlights. And also, I'm accountable to you, give you how far we have gone as a congregation, as a church, in regards to this subject, relating it to our theme for the year. We are coming close to the end of 2023, if you're counting days. And as a congregation, we started off this year with a theme of growing deeper, reaching wider, and extending influence. And so the good news is that our youth, or through the youth ministry, they did evangelism both amongst their age groups. They went to streets, particularly during the car-free dates. They were able to harvest some 10 souls. And through partnership with church plants and also through the True North Garage, 250 souls committed their lives to Jesus. Praise the Lord. So I sampled different ministries. I may not mention all the ministries, but I picked a few highlights. The adults, I'm talking about the time when we are ministering here at the pulpit, and also our discipleship journey for the adults, which happens every second service here, has about 60 people. They also went out, and as a result, we have had a harvest of 95 souls that gave their lives to Jesus. We really want to appreciate all those people that are behind this work. Now, the children ministry. The children ministry went to Ruhuha, to Busanza, to Bumbogo, and beyond the borders, they went to Arusha for a mission. And out of that, 285 souls came to the Lord. And so the total of those that have surrendered themselves to the Lordship of Jesus, as a sample, are 632 persons, and we want to thank God. We want to give God all the glory for what he's doing. And I told you, this is a few that I sampled. I believe that God has done more and is doing more, and we want to thank God for all the teachers, we want to thank God for all the parents that have supported their children. I want to let you know that it wasn't easy to let go the children go to Arusha. They did not only send their children, but they sacrificed. They took into their pockets and gave money. They gave money towards that cause. And can we appreciate them, please? Those are some of the mission fields. Now, it did not end there. They also gave out health insurance to 250 people, those are children now. And they were able to contribute school fees to 100 pupils. Do you know what that means? They went to preach, they had to go, okay? So imagine if they did not take a step of going. How would those souls have come to the knowledge of the truth about Jesus' love for them? And they did not only do that. And thank you once again, church, for supporting this cause. They took some clothes, they took some food and shared with them. And I want to imagine the smiles on the faces of those little ones as they were putting on those clothes that day. Praise the Lord. Do you understand God's mission now? Praise the Lord. It's bigger than you sitting now, please, okay? Sitting in the restaurant, you know, and enjoying a meal. It's bigger than that. Praise the Lord. You know, thinking about this message, I want you to help me here. I kind of thought about Jesus for the life that he lived here. And I'm like, so what was his mission? And what does he require of me and you? Okay? Because at the end of the day, we're going to give accountability of how we spent our time and how we were stewards of this message that God has handed unto us as messengers. Praise the Lord. It's very important. And so, it's not enough. I also want to share with us about discipleship. Like I told you, we have about 60 adults that have been on a journey of discipleship. 101, 201, just like it's tailored. It's tailored to our children's discipleship paradigm. 301, 401, and after that, they go out. They do what? If you miss that step, then somehow you've missed on what burdens the heart of God, on what brought Jesus, even when he knew he was going to be hanged and to be humiliated and to be flogged beyond recognition, but because of that mission, he came. And that's my assignment today to whoever is here listening. And so, we also have 240 children that are on this discipleship journey. So I want to clearly say, please, parents, you are good stewards of those children. Make sure they appear in Kids Connection and make sure they go through the discipleship, because I know the fruit. I know the fruit. My daughters have been there. And one of them, because she has clocked 18 this year, she has transitioned here. She says, well, I've grown. And you don't know what that means to a daddy. So even today, we had 401 graduate. It doesn't mean that they are finished. They are done. We have to continue working with them a journey. They have just finished a certain phase, so we have to work with them until we see them preaching like me here. And also, I want to share this so that you understand the cost of this. Because I've been at the first group that went to Arusha for a mission, I was with them. These kids have gone to the Maasai land to share the love of Christ with those teenagers who are already mothers. And this is the side of the story. There are no clear roads as you're going to those homesteads. There are trails, so you keep finding. Sometimes you get lost to a trail where the cattle have really passed, and you realize you're off, and you get yourself back. So they have experienced what it means to go and search for the lost. Let me read for us our text this morning. In the book of Luke, chapter 15, verses 4 to 7. Let's all go to the Word of God. I'm reading from New King James Version. The Bible says, what man of you, having 100 sheep, if he loses one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one which is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. I said to you, but likewise, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 just persons or good people who do not need to repent. Praise God. Keywords here. One is lost. Lost. And so I want you to indulge me here. Ask somebody next to you. Do we have people who are lost in our world? Do it. I want you to give me an answer. Do we have... Ask your neighbor. I'm just asking, but I want you to ask your neighbor. Do you have or do we have people who are lost in our world? Musumba, what is the answer? Plenty. Plenty. But Jesus is posing a question here, and I will give a background to this. He says, what man of you, having 100 sheep, if he loses one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one which is lost until he finds it? You know why he's sharing this story? The preceding verses, 1-3, talks about the scribes and Pharisees. These educated men, and probably women, I don't know, were complaining and they were murmuring that Jesus was seated and eating with sinners and tax collectors. Probably Zacchaeus was one of them. And they're busy saying, what kind of a person is that? Little did they know Jesus' mission here on earth. And it's possible for me and you to get busy with many, many other things or get caught up with the lifestyle of this world and forget our Father's mission. You know what? Thinking about this message, I asked myself about Jesus' lifestyle. Whenever Jesus went to the beach, he was going for a prayer retreat concerning his Father's mission. You're wondering whether he went to the beach. I mean, the waters were there even then. Okay? And whenever he went hiking in a mountain, he was going to pray. It just came as I was thinking. So he was fully kind of preoccupied with the mission about the lost sheep. And that was the business. And that is the business. He's inviting you and me to come in partnership and do our Father's business. So I asked, do we have people who are lost in our world? I want to narrow it. Ask your neighbor, do you have one who is lost in your family? One. Oh, what did she say? Oh, I'm hearing many ones who are lost in our family. Do you see, can you begin now sensing the burden of Jesus? Do you see why he could go into the wilderness for 40 days and nights? Could you be one among those ones? I was, and probably I could be among the ones. You could be seated here, troubled, lost. Am I making sense here? And he came for you. He came for me. You count. You matter. That's all. In your family, counts. It doesn't matter whether right now they are nursing what do they call that? I'm forgetting how they used to call it in my high school. When these boys would go drink, they would have hangovers. Some guys have slept in bars and they cannot raise their head out of their beds. Jesus loves them. He wants you to go to them. He doesn't want you to judge them or to condemn them. Are they lost? Yes, they are. Do we see them? Do we have them? Yes, we do. I do. Okay. I want us to move a little bit. How about, and I want to preach with you. Ask your neighbor, how about in your neighborhood? Is there one who is lost? There are people whom I'm losing this side of the corner. Ask your neighbor, and let us preach this message together. Is there one who is lost in your neighborhood? Are they saying yes? Is it a yes or no? Yes! There are many ones. And that is our Father's business. That is what has burdened his heart. And he wants you to be burdened by what has burdened him. Okay, maybe, Pastor, that is obvious. How about, look at your neighbor again. In your work space, don't worry, you may not be working. I will come to your space as well. How about there? Is there someone or is there one who is lost? What did she say? Yes, they are there. I'm coming. Students, your classmates, people you go to with or you go with to school, is there one who is lost? Have you met one who is lost? Well, I can feel in there are many ones. How about on the social media platforms? Are they there? Many. Are we on that space? Are we in that space as well? I guarantee you, even our children have got these gadgets. So you have the gadgets, so you're able to notice that someone is lost. But Jesus poses the question, what man of you, after losing one sheep, does not leave the 99 to look for the one which is lost until he finds it? So the second keyword is go. Go. Go after them until you find them. And the third keyword that I will talk about, and that's the Great Commission, by the way. That is the reason or the business that Jesus wants us to transact. Go after that one which is lost. And that is going to be my charge to all of us. Because I believe that there is that one. Could be your spouse, could be your child, could be your sister or auntie, or friend, classmate. I don't know. But there is one somewhere who is lost. And Jesus is challenging us to go after that one. And the other important point that I want to highlight here, when you find them, tell them about God's love and bring them in the house of the Lord and let us rejoice with them. I know, yeah, you heard me. Let us rejoice. They are there. We have all agreed that they are there. But we also have to agree that that is exactly the Great Commission. That is why the church exists. And I want to thank God for all those that have participated in one way or the other. You may go or you may send. Okay? Because that is what defines the mission. Praise the Lord. Just imagine if these guys, the Derricks and the rest, did not go for car-free day. They went. The first time, they were able to fish six. The second time, they got four. And there are many cells that are doing this. So I want to challenge us as a church, even as we come closer to the end of this year, to plan and make sure that at the end of it all, we have somebody who is in the heart of God coming to the knowledge of truth. Key points here. The lost sheep. Jesus begins the parable by asking, which shepherd, having 100 sheep, would not leave the 99 in the wilderness to search for the lost sheep? This part of the parable emphasizes the value of each individual and the length of God is willing to go to seek out and save that which is lost. Can you imagine? God did not withhold his one and only begotten son, Jesus Christ. How much should we do? How much should we do? And he's inviting you and me. And I'm going to share with you my heart once I am through with this. I need to rush through this. Secondly, rejoicing in heaven. The parable continues with the shepherd finding the lost sheep and joyfully carrying it back to the flock. Jesus emphasizes here that there is more joy in heaven over one sinner who turns away from his sinful ways, who leaves the lifestyle of addictions, who leaves the lifestyle of immorality and quits all that mess and comes back in the flock. Can you imagine the joy that is in heaven? Can you imagine the banquet that is set? Do you want to partner with Jesus in this mission? Do you? Bless you, buddy. You want. I'll be praying that God will use you. And they are there. And if you don't go, nobody will speak to them about the love of God. Why missions? As I quickly go through this. Let's together read in the book of Luke chapter 4 verses 18. Why missions? The Bible says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of the sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. This is in reference to Isaiah 61, verses 1 and 2. And Jesus states very clearly his mission. So why mission? It is God's heartbeat. That is the great commission. Jesus wants to redeem us. He wants to redeem mankind. And he wants you to partner with him to reconcile men to himself. He accepted to die so that you and me may not get lost forever. And he's now setting the challenge before us. Do you mind that your neighbor is perishing? Do you mind? Do you mind that your workmate is taken up by that lifestyle that does not please God? Your duty is simply extending the love of Jesus to them. You can, you know, invite them for a cup of tea or coffee and begin by making them your friends and have, you know, that casual conversation. And before you know, you will have shared with them the love of God. Some are these people that have backslidden. They have been in the fold. They have been part of the family of God. And at one point, they have lost it. Probably, I know I've heard these stories of people who have taken their prayer petition before God and it has taken long to come through and they feel like God does not exist. Just because something temporary has failed, you lose eternal life. And God is calling me and you not to judge them, but to go to them and remind them of why Jesus went on that cross. He loves them. He loves them. Are you ready to go? Very quickly, the world is broken and they need a healer. That is another reason why you should go. Why you should do what? Go. You could be the one here today that is heartbroken. Jesus loves you. And he sent me to remind you that he loves you. And he wants to heal you. He wants to amend your brokenness. He wants you to know that you are precious in his eyes. People are in captivity. And Jesus wants you and me to partner with him to proclaim. He is depending on you and me to proclaim the good news. They are oppressed. They need that liberty. They need to hear that. They are blind towards the truth. And so I want to end this because my time is out by making this statement, which was said by John Hagee. John Hagee said that we are indeed the light of the world, but only if our switch is on or turned on. Only. We are indeed the light of the world, but only if our switch is turned on. So, if you do not share the light of Jesus to your brother, sister, or auntie, or friend, or workmate who is lost, your switch is off, and therefore they cannot see. They are in darkness. I want to challenge us, even as I bring this to conclusion, to ponder about this truth. I want us to raise on our feet. Reflect about this. We're going to pray. You heard the song that we are singing that says, "Mold me, Lord. Guide me, Lord. Walk beside me. Fill me and use me." God wants to use you and me. You don't need to be very eloquent. You don't need to be old. You just need to be available. I want you to pray in your heart and ask Jesus. This is a reminder to us that every soul counts. And ask God to come into your heart again and stir up that burden for the lost souls and help you to love like he loves and help you to care like he cares and help you to be active, proactive towards this great commission. Say, "Lord Jesus, thank you for today. You have reminded me of the great commission. And I pray that you will help me to pursue it relentlessly and fulfill it." Hold the hand of your neighbor right now. Hold the hand of your neighbor. I want you to pray for that person. He could be having issues that have hurt them. Pray for them. Pray that Jesus will shine his light in their hearts. Jesus will touch his light in their lives. He will make a difference today. That they will not walk out of this auditorium the way they came in. That God will heal them because he is a healer. That God will set them free because he is our deliverer. But God will change them forever and will make their tastes turn it around into a testimony. Do it. Pray for them. Pray for them. Could be they are burdened by their families. Pray that Jesus will give them grace to know what to do and how to go about it, to ensure that their lights are switched on. We can only do that. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you for your work. And as we pray through this message, I pray that, Lord, we will be mindful of the fact that you came to seek and save that one sheep that is lost. Help us to love our neighbors as we love ourselves, and help us to love you by responding to the call of the Great Commission. Bless your children. In Jesus' name I prayed. Amen. God bless you.
Well, thank you so much. Another round of applause for Pastor for such a timely message. So I don't know about you, but for me, this starting this morning to this point, the Holy Spirit has convicted me big time. I have realized how much selfish I have been. And in fact, in the name of, you know, it's a busy world. There's a lot of things happening. I'm too busy to get time to talk to someone. And this is another one where I have conveniently abdicated my responsibility to the pastors. I have one of those passionate friends who are after souls. And I said, those will do. But my friends, today I have been reminded. I've been reminded that I have a role to play. And therefore, my prayer is courage to be able to take the first step in faith and talk to the friend, the pastor, that one that Pastor mentioned. And for me, I don't have just one, unfortunately. I have plenty of ones. And I pray that God will equip us, will send us indeed as you go to the world with courage, with utterance, and really the love that we sing, the love of our God, that it shall be clearly evident in our lives. So thank you so much, Pastor. May God bless you so much for reawakening this into our hearts. Let's again thank God so much for this timely message. Now, as we conclude our fellowship, I just have a few verbals and reminders. One is that in case you wanted to give your offering and tithe using POS, there's a friend, actually a couple of friends right under the Mercy Ministry banner that will give you ways, will show you how to do that. And also for late offering slots, there is right at the back, you find an opportunity to do your offering in cash, but also right under the Mercy Ministry banner, they'll give you the Momo codes that you can use. The wonderful visitors, you remember the special people I mentioned earlier on? Please make your way right at the end of our fellowship. Go to the extreme right, is a hospitality room. You'll find wonderful people that will speak to you, pray with you, and also answer any questions you might have about CLA. Then, a reminder, there's a lost and found table. Please, if you feel you lost something here, pass by. And the cell, the cell. We are a cell-based church. So if you don't belong to any cell and you want to plug into the cell, please go under the cell information. They will give you more information about which cell is meeting in your location. And please find a place where you can actually plug in and rejoice together with brethren. And even, you know what, potentially do mission together. So it's an opportunity for you. So thank you once again for blessing us to this afternoon, for coming to fellowship together with us. And I pray that the Lord will bless you greatly. So shall we rise and share the words of our grace, of grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. May God bless you. I'll see you next Sunday.